The name of the chapter is Mixtures. So, in a mixture, two or more substances are present in any ratio. The ratio is not fixed. So, they are present in any ratio, that is called a mixture. And these substances can be elements. They can be compounds or even both. We can have element and a compound also. So general properties of these mixtures will be they contain particles of more than one kind. Like if we take elements, elements have particles of one type only, but here particles of more than one kind, no definite set of properties. The properties can vary and various constituents, various components retain their original properties in a mixture. Various constituents, they don't lose their properties. Like when we get a compound, when we make a compound, various constituents lose their properties, but they will retain their properties and can also be separated by physical means. No chemical reaction is required. Just by physical means, we can separate various components of a mixture. We can have a homogeneous mixture or heterogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture means it will have uniform composition throughout. We can take out any portion of a homogeneous mixture. It will have the similar composition throughout at different parts. For example, if you take alloy, all alloys are homogeneous mixtures. Bronze. Bronze is a homogeneous mixture of copper and tin. If you take brass, it is a homogeneous mixture of copper and zinc. So these will be homogeneous. If you put some salt in water, so that is homogeneous mixture. Heterogeneous mixtures don't have uniform composition. Different parts will have different composition. So that is called heterogeneous. Like if you put some sand in water, that is heterogeneous. If you take gunpowder, gunpowder is a heterogeneous mixture of charcoal, sulfur, and potassium nitrate. That's a homogeneous mixture, heterogeneous. Like suppose if I take some oil, some alcohol and water. So both are these miscible, they mix with each other, na? So when they are miscible, it is a homogeneous mixture. So if I say how to separate this mixture, alcohol from water. So if you just say by heating, that is not right because alcohol vapors can catch fire. So it is by distillation. So the principle of distillation should be, it is there should be difference in the boiling points. We can apply this distillation method for separation only if there is difference in the boiling points of two components. And the difference should be at least by 15 degrees C. Because if it is less than 15, then we have to do fractional distillation. So this is miscible homogeneous mixture. But if you take oil in water is not miscible, it becomes immiscible. And that becomes heterogeneous. But both are mixtures only, no? But this is heterogeneous. So how can you separate oil from water? So you can say with the help of separating funnel. And the principle of separating funnel is there should be difference in the densities of two liquids. So if you take oil and water, which is heavier here? Oil is water is heavier, oil is lighter. Oil is lighter. So we will take a separating funnel. Separating funnel has a stopcock at the bottom, which can be opened, and we can take out water from that. So in this separating funnel, put this immiscible mixture, oil and water, and thoroughly shake it. So after shaking it, we will leave it for some time. Then water will form the below layer, oil is upper. So by opening the stopcock at the bottom, water can be taken out, and oil will be left behind in the separating funnel. So this was a heterogeneous mixture. So there are various methods of separating the mixtures. And if we take water mixtures, various water mixtures, they can be classified into, actually it will, we are doing classification on the basis of size of particles. So they can be classified into true solutions, suspensions, and colloids on the basis of size of dissolved particles, in the solvent called dispersion medium. Actually for colloids, we call the solute as the dispersed phase and the solvent as the dispersion medium. So this classification is done on the basis of size of particles. So we can do some properties in the tabular form, like solution, colloids, and suspension. So if we take a solution will have particle size to be less than 10 raised to power minus 9 meter, and colloids have in between size of solution and suspension, it is 1 to 1000 nanometer, and you know 1 nanometer is 10 raised to power minus 9 meter. So this, the range is from 10 raised to power minus 9 to 10 raised to power minus 6 meter. So if the particle size is smaller than 10 raised to power minus 9 meter, it becomes a solution. If it is more than 10 raised to power minus 6 meter, it will be a suspension. So suspension will have maximum size of the particles. Second is, in solution actually we call solute and solvent. So in solution we can say dispersed particles or solute can pass through filter paper also. If we take an ordinary filter paper, the dispersed particles will be able to pass through, and through semi-permeable membrane also. Cellophane sheet can be used as semi-permeable membrane, or we can have pig bladder. Actually, semi-permeable membrane is that which will allow the solvent particles to pass through, but not the bigger solute particles. Smaller particles can pass through, but not bigger. But this smaller in solution, the particle size is so small that they can pass through semi-permeable membrane also. Small particles can pass through. Colloids will, we can say particles can pass through filter paper, but not through semi-permeable membrane. And this is the principle which is used for dialysis. In kidney patients, blood is purified by this only because blood is a colloid. So colloids, they are not able to pass through semi-permeable membranes. And suspension, the particle size is so big that they cannot pass through. Either through the filter paper or through the semi-permeable membrane. Particle size in suspension is maximum. Then this not visible to naked eye. Because the particle size is so small in solution, not visible. And in this colloids also not visible. But suspension, the particle size is visible. Actually, solutions are homogeneous. Solution is nothing but a homogeneous mixture. So this is homogeneous. Colloids like blood or milk, they look to be heterogeneous, but they look to be homogeneous, but they are hetero. So colloids are heterogeneous and suspensions of course are heterogeneous. If we take solution, the particles do not settle down. If you leave for some time, particles don't settle down. Particle size is very small and they will keep suspended. In colloids, again don't settle down. And suspensions will settle down. The particles, they will settle down in the given solvent, whatever it is. If you take colloids, various examples of colloids are, if you take froth or soap leather, this is the example of colloid, gas in liquid. Dispersed phase is gas, dispersion medium is liquid. Like we have 9 types of colloids in which dispersed phase and dispersion medium is different. Like dispersion medium can be liquid also, dispersion medium can be solid also or gas also. Like if you take milk, milk is a colloid in which liquid is dispersed in liquid. Dispersed phase is also liquid, dispersion medium is also liquid. And suspensions can be, you can take chalk in water, that becomes suspension. Now these colloids have two very typical properties which are not shown by suspension and solutions. One is this Brownian motion. So Brownian motion is the property of colloids. It is named on the name of the scientist only, Brownian motion. So Brownian motion is the random movement of colloidal particles. Colloidal particles can also be called dispersed phase. So random movement of colloidal particles in the dispersion medium. So this is zigzag motion of various colloidal particles. And what is the reason for this? Why this random movement is taking place? It is due to collisions of colloidal particles with the molecules of dispersion medium. And this Brownian motion is responsible for a colloid to be stable. We just saw that colloids are stable. So colloids are stable because of this property only. That the molecules or the dispersed phase particles, they remain suspended. So this Brownian motion is responsible for the colloids to be stable. One more property of colloids is Tyndall effect. So Tyndall effect is defined as scattering of light by colloidal particles. In different directions. So when beam of light is passed through colloidal particles, scattering of light beam in by colloidal particles in different directions is called Tyndall effect. So this is a very special property of this colloid by which they can be differentiated. So Tyndall effect can be seen in a picture hall also. When there is projection of a picture, then we can see the path of light. So that path of light can be, and this due to this scattering of light, the path of light becomes visible. Because scattering is taking place, due to this scattering, the path of beam of light becomes visible. So in a picture hall, this path of light can be seen, and dust particles act as colloidal particles. So dust particles are able to scatter the beam of light in different directions, so we can see the path of light. Similarly, in the morning time also, when sunlight enters the room, then we can see the path of that sunlight. We can see, and the dust particles floating in the air also. So that is also due to Tyndall effect. So all these solutions, suspensions and colloids, they are nothing but out of these, solution was a homogeneous mixture. So any homogeneous mixture is also called a solution. And out of these colloids and suspension, both are nothing but heterogeneous mixtures. In homogeneous mixtures, suppose if we want to separate two gases. So two gases can, suppose if we have ammonia and HCl, and we want to separate these two gases. So how can we do it? It is the two gases will diffuse. The rate of diffusion is different. So we can say that if the gas is heavier, then the rate of diffusion will be slow. So here ammonia has a molecular mass of 17, HCl has a molecular mass of 36.5. So rate of diffusion is inversely proportional to square root of density. Or we can also say R1 by R2, it is also square root of molecular masses. So if we want to compare the rates of these two gases, then ammonia will diffuse faster. So HCl will come in the numerator and ammonia will come here. So ammonia being a lighter gas, it will diffuse faster. If we want to compare the rates of diffusion of hydrogen and oxygen, then molecular mass of oxygen will come in the numerator, hydrogen here. So this is 4. So you can also say that rate of diffusion or effusion means the same thing. Diffusion is because of difference in the concentration. Effusion is because of difference in the pressure. So rate of diffusion of hydrogen is 4 times faster than of oxygen gas. So if the gas is lighter, it can effuse more. That is why we should handle this petrol with care, because as compared to diesel, petrol contains lighter fractions of hydrocarbons. So its rate of diffusion or effusion will be much, much faster. And if you have carbon monoxide and oxygen, then they can be separated by liquefaction because they differ in their rate of liquefaction. So alright, so that was about mixtures, various types of mixtures, their separation methods. Okay then.